Podcasting from Singapore and broadcasting all around the world. You're listening to the EdTech Chat Podcast, taking the pulse of educators from all over the globe and bringing what you need every week. Now, over to your host, Craig Kemp.
Hello and welcome to episode 31 of the EdTech Chat Podcast. I'm your host, Craig Kemp, and I'm thrilled to have your support. I continue to work with the incredibly talented Mark Quinn to improve the final audio quality of this podcast. He has his own podcast production studio that provides editing and mastering services to content creators. To connect with Mark, please see the details in the podcast notes below. As I've mentioned before, I've grown my Ignite EdTech consultancy team to include some of the best EdTech leaders from all over the globe. Each week, I want to take a few moments to introduce a new member of our team that you may like to chat to about supporting you in your school or company. Today, it's my pleasure to introduce you to Ivo Hanan. Let's have a listen to our chat. Ivo, thank you so much for joining me today. As a valued member of the Ignite EdTech consulting team, you work with schools all over the world to help them thrive in many different ways. Tell us a little bit about your current role, your experience, and your areas of expertise.
Hi, Craig. Thank you for having me on board. So a little bit about myself. I'm 20 years in education as a classroom teacher and as a leader. Six of those years were spent in the UK. 14 years and now currently in Dubai, leading design and innovation in an IB World School. My main passions relate to promoting design thinking and entrepreneurship and allowing kids to be prepared for the future.
Awesome, man. And, you know, I follow a lot of what you do online for the greater good of education and connecting and collaborating. What are you most passionate about in education right now?
So I think as we start to move out of 2020, it's becoming really clear to most people that we're not developing a culture where students or teachers are forward-thinking enough. So something that I'm currently working on right now is how to help schools develop this approach in education to be more forward-thinking by considering diversity, multiculturalism, innovation, student agency, well-being, so on and so forth.
And tell us about a time when you helped others succeed and thrive.
So I would say, I mean, out of the few examples that I can pick out, the one that I run currently at the moment every week on Sundays is Ed Talks Live, which includes two main guests and a staff room of 10 other guests. And what's happened here, and that was something I was hoping for, was that people would develop relationships and develop collaborations throughout these relationships that have been created during the talk show. And funnily enough, over the past 3 or 4 weeks, I've had people from different parts of the world who've connected live on the show, who didn't know each other, who are now actually working together on collaborative projects. So it's great to see how one small drop in the ocean can develop such great opportunities for others around us.
And I've seen it in action, Ivo, and you've created an absolute beast. It's really, really cool to see. And I know that people listening here today are going to want to know how to connect with you and what you can do to help them, whether it's in a school or as an EdTech company. So how do you help schools, or how can you help schools and EdTech companies benefit from the work that you can do with them?
I mean, the most important thing is to help companies and schools develop this idea of a culture of innovation, to continually question their practice and develop change for the better and move forward a little bit, connecting to what I was saying before about forward-thinking schools. I've created a model called Innovation X, and that very much identifies how to do that in a simple way. And I think with that in mind, keeping things modern and helping teams, employees, teachers understand that they can all be empowered to make a difference is hopefully what I can contribute in the near future.
Awesome. For more information about Ivo and the rest of the Ignite EdTech consulting team and how to inquire, visit igniteedtech.com/our team. The link is in the description below. Ivo, thank you so much for joining me today.
Thanks, Craig. All the best, guys.
Last week, I asked you to think about well-being and your digital well-being program. I encourage you to take a look back at the social streams to see what people suggested and listen back to last week's episode. This week, I want you to think about how to be your best with digital tools over this upcoming holiday season. It's so easy to be plonked down on the couch and sitting on your device, but how good is it for your well-being and the well-being of your family? What are your holiday season plans? Have you thought about device use for you and your family? Maybe it's a good opportunity to put together a family media agreement so you can get out and get active more. I'd love to hear your plans for the coming weeks. I look forward to hearing from you soon. A tool that has positively impacted the authentic and purposeful use of technology into classrooms and meeting rooms that I have worked in is Book Creator. Book Creator is a simple tool for creating awesome digital books. You can create your own teaching resources or have your students take the reins. Create easily using any text form and on any device. It's an incredible tool that can be used by kids of any age in a K-12 setting and is particularly useful in a K-6 environment. It doesn't matter what subject or grade level you're teaching, students can demonstrate their understanding by creating a book. 2 million books are made every month in Book Creator from countries all over the world. With a free individual account, you can store up to 40 books and publish to one library. And for just $10 a month, teachers can create unlimited libraries and store hundreds of books. A perfect suite for teachers of any age level. I highly recommend you take a look at bookcreator.com. The link is in the description below. Every week, I bring you a short interview with some of my edu heroes, an engaging learning experience with someone who makes a difference in education every day, with a particular focus or angle towards educational technology. This week, I had the pleasure of chatting with Steve Isaacs and Alex Quigley. Let's have a listen to the chats. Today, I have the honor of speaking with Steve Isaacs. You might know him as @Mr_Isaacs on Twitter. Steve is a teacher in game development and has been recognized by ISTE, the International Society for Technology and Education, as an outstanding teacher. He's an esports leader and Minecraft mentor and is based in the US. Steve, it's a pleasure to have you on the show today. Are you ready to talk education and technology integration?
Absolutely, Craig. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. Let's go. Why don't you start by telling us a little bit about your current role and what inspires you to do what you do?
Sure. So I teach game design and development at a middle and high school. In fact, this was my first year up at the high school. So for my 27 or so year career, I've been only at the middle school level. In fact, I even started in special education and then moved into technology and then developed the game design program that I run now. And for many years, it was basically just seventh and eighth grade. And I've been wanting to be able to offer a program at our high school for a number of reasons. One is that when I would run into kids that are at the high school, you know, they would quickly tell me how great the high school is, except for the fact that there was no game design program up there. So I really wanted to provide that. I also had great ideas for developing a whole like game design studio model with multiple levels of the course and, you know, really working from, you know, beginning through publishing games and the potential for the high school students with some of the tools that might be more challenging at the middle school level, you know, is tremendous. So, you know, I knew that when I got up to the high school, I could push things even further. So when you ask what makes me excited about it, it's like the idea that my high school kids, you know, can certainly take what I've started them with and then run with products like Unreal Engine and Unity and other things and really develop some pretty amazing content for, you know, in terms of games and also for virtual reality and other technologies.
And I think one of the things that I get all the time in the work that I do is people asking about gamification and gaming and does it have a place in education? So I think one of the things the listeners would love to hear about from an expert that's been in this game for so long now, tell us a little bit about gaming and your feelings about where it fits within education.
Sure. So one thing, gaming is absolutely meaningful and relevant to our students. So it definitely takes us to that point of like, you know, kind of making, you know, learning meaningful to them, right? Now, of course, that doesn't mean we're just going to go in the classroom and play games, but when we can leverage the power of the games and the games kids are already playing, I think we've hit on something. I always use Minecraft as an example because, you know, parents and others might kind of ask that question, like, wait, if my kid's playing Minecraft at home all the time, why do I you know, want to bring that, or why do I need to bring that into school? And my response is kind of, that's exactly why we should bring it into school. Our kids come to us with expertise in these areas. Minecraft happens to have the potential as a sandbox environment to allow kids to create anything they can imagine. So when we tie that with our learning outcomes and we let kids create in an environment that is exciting to them, then they, you know, outperform what they would do otherwise. So there's definitely that piece. And now with esports, you know, becoming so big as well, we start to see that the game industry, and this is also ties in with what I do with game design, the industry is huge. So it's like when we talk about career opportunities and career readiness, we're talking about tapping into a multi-billion dollar market that that alone means a lot. And not only is it about the game or the game player, but it's all of the other roles that are involved. So when you talk about game design, you talk about so many different skill sets like graphics and animation, sound engineering, story writing, those sorts of things. And when you get into esports, you start to see all the surrounding roles like, you know, the broadcasting and shoutcasting. And, you know, here we are on your podcast, right? What a great way to get kids into podcasting is when it's a topic that's important to them. And then they do all the research they need to, and they produce a wonderful show, you know, and that kind of ties it together. So, you know, I think it's, you know, we're really providing opportunities for kids that go beyond schooling for sure.
So when we talk about those opportunities, Steve, what about advice for educators, those listening today, in relation to educational technology in general? What's your best advice for them?
I think people are our greatest resource. Ever since I got, you know, really involved on like Twitter and such, I've grown my network of people that I, you know, and I'll use the term, the expression again, learn with and from tremendously. So when I do have a question, there's this huge network of people I can go to. I can often tweet a question out and get 10 responses in minutes, you know. And likewise, I love sharing with others about the things that I'm excited about. So I think you start to find your community of people when you start to expand your network that way. And for me, that just fills me up. I mean, I have people that, you know, that I'm that like-minded, you know, I love meeting up with people that have similar ideas and passions as I do. I might not find them necessarily in the classroom next door in my school building, especially since I teach something kind of unique. So I find that, you know, outside and that nourishes me. So that's my biggest tip, I think, is just to embrace the potential of other passionate educators.
In education, in our schools, we've got access to so many tools and so many things. And you've spoken about professional learning networks and your engagement in there to get what you want and when you what you want and when you need it. But what about educational technology tools? We often hear you've got to know your why before you jump into any tool. But what's a tool that you're currently using in your classroom or your day-to-day work that everyone needs to know about?
Wow. So many, I think, in a way. I'll take a step back from that, though, and I will say that it gets overwhelming sometimes when we hear about all these tools and think that we need to know, you know, all these different tools, so to speak. I think it's most important when you come to find, you know, what it is you're really looking for and something that solves that problem. For me, one of the tools, when I think of EdTech tools that I really love is ClassCraft, which I've been using. And it's actually, it becomes important now too with what we're doing with remote learning, because my whole class is set up. It's a gamified learning management system in a way. It used to be more of just a gamified platform for turning your class into a game, but there's also a full quest system in it now, which allows you to put in branching assignment paths. I'm very into student choice and choice-based learning, so it provides that for me perfectly. Like I set up different quests and kids can choose where they start, and as they complete a quest, another one opens up. But now that we're in this remote learning situation, all of my projects and assignments are already available online. So my kids, know how to, log in, check what quest they want to work on, start working on it. There's a communication system within. My grading system works through experience points instead of like a grade, so to speak. So that's all built into this. So for me, that has served many valuable purposes, both in school and now that we're out of some. And then I also am just a huge fan of creation tools, like any content creation tools that really get students involved in creating. So for me, like Fortnite Creative has become a big tool. You don't usually think of it as an ed tech tool, so to speak. Minecraft, Make Code Arcade, which is uses Microsoft's Make Code block-based coding language to have kids create retro-style arcade games. So all of these kinds of things where kids get to create, to me, those are the tools we want to, really leverage. Gosh, also there's like Twine to allow kids to make choice-based adventure games, which also serves very well in like the English language arts area, because you could have kids, writing, but with an interesting game-like twist to it. So those are just a few, but again, for me, it's always content creation. And then with Classcraft, that's what helps me organize my life for me and my students.
If you're listening to this and you want to follow up with some of the things Steve said, all of the links to these are below in the description and in the podcast comments. And Steve, what about learning in general? As educators, we focus so much time on other people's learning, and we sometimes neglect our own learning. And whether that's to the detriment of our own progression or not, what about for you? What's a book or resource that you've been reading lately that you want to recommend?
Oh, good question. So, see, for me, it's interesting because my approach to learning is often like hands-on. So I've been excited about learning, like, let's say, how to use Unreal Engine. And for that, I've gone to a Udemy course. So I've been, learning online that way. I listen very regularly to the On Education podcast with Mike Washburn and Glenn Irvin. And I just really appreciate their podcast has always a big section where the two of them are talking about just current trends and issues in education. And then they always have special guests that that have a lot of insight to share.
Steve, you've given us so many nuggets of wisdom here, so many things for us to go away and think about, particularly if you're listening today and you've heard that word gamification or gaming or any of those sorts of terms thrown around, even Minecraft EDU, those sorts of things that are being discussed in schools every day. If the listeners want to get in touch with you to talk a little bit more, how do they do that?
Absolutely, through Twitter. Very active and very attentive to, direct messages and such. So you had mentioned earlier, my Twitter handle is at Mr. Mr. Isaacs, I-S-A-A-C-S. I'm also on like Discord because we use that a lot in a number of the professional development networks I'm involved in and things like that. So I'm pretty easy to find.
Thanks, Steve. I absolutely will include all of those. Thank you so much for your time today.
Oh, my pleasure, Craig. Thank you.
Today, I have the honor of speaking with Alex Quigley. You might know him as @HuntingEnglish on Twitter. Alex is a former English teacher and currently works as the National Content Manager at the Education Endowment Foundation in England. His work focuses on supporting teachers to access research evidence, and on top of all of this, he's also a published author. Alex, it's a pleasure to have you on the show today. Are you ready to talk about education and technology integration?
I am, Craig. Thank you for having me.
Absolute pleasure. Let's go. Why don't you start by telling us a little bit about your current role and what inspires you to do what you do?
Okay, so I currently work for the Education Endowment Foundation, which is a charity in England that works with schools. It has a focus on supporting schools and teachers to access research evidence with the aim of trying to close the gap between children from disadvantaged backgrounds and their peers. I joined the EEF a couple of years ago after working in a school for over 15 years, and it's been kind of part of a gradual move to writing for teachers, training with teachers. So my role as National Content Manager means that I get to try and mediate lots of different types of research evidence and try and support schools and teachers to access some really useful insights and guidance.
It sounds like a really exciting role, Alex, and something that gives you a bigger oversight in what's happening in the world today. What excites you about education today?
We are in a very unusual moment, I think, with this global pandemic. I think even with this kind of the serious issues around the global pandemic, what we have more than we've ever had before is a real global audience of educators. We have so much information at our fingertips. I think what we've seen over the past 5 or 6 years is the likes of those social networks have seen distances close. They've seen expertise shared. And for me, I think it means that we're better prepared when new challenges come along. So, you know, I'm having a conversation here with yourself. In the last few weeks, I've shared resources with colleagues and organizations in Australia and the US, as well as across England. So I get excited by how there's so much access to communication, to new ideas and to existing evidence, and how that's kind of reshaping education.
I'm a big fan of research in particular. And as an educator, I've never had time for it, never been able to jump in and focus on it. And I rely a lot on people like you who are out there, and it's your job to help find and give evidence to, you know, the reasons why we do what we do. And I'm a big believer in the why. And I always point back to Simon Sinek, who says, people don't buy what you do, they buy why you do it. And in particular, I think the work that you're doing around how does digital technology and the use of digital technology improve learning. What's your best advice for educators listening today in relation to EdTech?
To borrow an idea that it's not mine, it's from Professor Steve Higgins from Durham University in England. He says he actually poses the Bananarama principle. It isn't what you do, it's the way that you do it. And I think when it comes to EdTech, I think that really strikes home for me, in that we can often get attracted to EdTech because it's new, because there's something really innovative about it. But actually, we need to think harder about how well we do that. And we also need to think around how well it's implemented by, frankly, busy teachers. And so I think for me, we should be excited by new solutions. We should also be really circumspect and think, okay, how is a busy teacher, full teaching timetable, lots of other challenges they face, how are they going to learn and access any new technology? How's it going to integrate with the 100 things that they already have as habits? So for me, it's about thinking about not just the why and not just about the exciting innovations that technology can offer. It's about how will we get our heads around it? How will we integrate new tools? How we integrate old tools into our existing habits? And I think we need to think harder about that, really. And I think so it sounds like a circumspect message. It is. But it's one that's about guarding teachers, because I think what we can be too excited by new innovations, and we often don't think about what innovation we're going to decommission, what we're going to stop doing. And I think that's got just as much worth. And I think what we're facing currently, we've got, you know, a radically changed school system where remote learning has almost instantly, overnight, become much more significant in the working weeks and as a priority for most teachers. And that's shown how adaptable teachers are and how crucial technology can be to mediate learning. But we also need to think at the same time, okay, so we've got these new approaches. Also, let's really think hard about how that's going to be supported in terms of training for teachers, how we're going to find time for that, and what we're going to stop doing again. So I think I've got a cautious optimism. And one of the pieces of guidance that you can draw out from the research evidence about using EdTech is recommendation that we pose in the EF Guidance Report on using digital technology to improve learning. And it seems a really simple and obvious recommendation, but that actually, I think it's common sense, but it can be a little uncommon at times, is that we've got to think, how does that technology improve teaching and learning before we introduce it? We can't think, okay, this is a great new app, let's get going and let's see how it goes. We've got to think, what problem is this technology solving, and start from there.
And I'll include the link that you've shared in the show notes description. Oh, Alex, point us to an EdTech tool, Alex, that you currently love using in your day-to-day work.
It's probably not an exciting new one for people, but I'm finding that the more and more I use Microsoft Teams, the more I enjoy the different functionality. I've kind of, over the past 3 or 4 years, used lots of different platforms for that kind of connectivity, Slack and others, and actually, and Zoom more recently, and still use those other platforms. But I think Teams has been really accessible. I think they've been really good to connect with the kind of remote video meetings, but also it's just a nice platform for sharing documents, for chats, and it syncs up quite well, I think, with other resources. So I don't think it's not exciting as a different new innovation, but I think Teams is proving itself to be a real boon at the moment.
Learning is important to all of us, Alex, especially you and I as educators, and I know the people listening today are mostly educators and teachers that are working day-to-day in classrooms now. Recommend one book or resource that you've been reading lately, or one of your all-time favorites, and tell us why we should be exploring it.
So it's probably the hardest question. Lots of different resources that I very much enjoy and reading. I think without kind of focusing too exclusively on my own work, I think one of the things at the EF we've been working on over the past couple of months is resources for schools in response to the pandemic and in response to school closures. And our COVID-19 resources are really useful. But I particularly would point out, we did a rapid review on remote learning, and we brought out some recommendations around that, which are really useful. And that, for me, it was new evidence for me, actually. It was rapidly brought together to respond to this new issue. And there were just one or two aspects of it that really struck home for me as new learning. So the language of synchronous and asynchronous learning, that's become overnight something that lots and lots of teachers have begun to understand around remote technology. I think the evidence seems to indicate that there's no great difference between both of those. And there was a recommendation also drawn from this review of the evidence around the importance of social communication via remote learning. And that made me think much harder around, how do we keep the motivation up, you know, from this kind of remote basis? How do we keep that social dynamic of students going when obviously there are some physical barriers to that social connectivity? So for me, it was that rapid review on remote learning. It brought to home some new knowledge, and it feels very salient for the issues that teachers are facing now.
On top of all of this, Alex, you're a published author yourself. Tell us about your book. What inspired you to write it, and why should we read it?
So my latest book is called Closing the Reading Gap. It's the brother or sister of Closing the Vocabulary Gap. And I've written both of those books to try and crystallize what is a really crucial issue in terms of children from disadvantaged backgrounds. Children, pretty much all children who access school, have to mediate the language of school. They have to access the language of school. And if a child doesn't have the vocabulary, if they don't have supports outside of the school gates, they can really struggle accessing the school curriculum. So I wanted to provide an evidence-based but really accessible way of unpacking vocabulary and reading, these really key aspects of every single school day, try and make them really accessible, the evidence about what the issues are, but also lots of practical strategies. And it's part of, I think, my time on social media over the past 7 or 8 years and my experience. I began as a middle leader in a school who joined Twitter, basically looking for some answers, struggling through trying to work out how I could guide my colleagues and how I could teach better myself. And I've been in a privileged position to write some books now. And my latest book on reading, it's very much the book I felt I needed a few years ago when I was really looking for, okay, what do I need to know about reading or vocabulary, and what can I do about it? And I think that practical aspect was really key. So that's my pitch, really. And these are areas where I think they matter for every teacher. There are some misconceptions the world over around vocabulary or reading is somebody else's job. When actually for maths teachers, for science teachers, having the academic language of school and being able to read like a scientist is actually really vital for school success. So that's why I write about those areas.
Thanks for sharing that as well, Alex. And we'll make sure the links to your books are in the podcast description below as well. What's the best way for the audience listening today to follow and connect with you?
So as you mentioned at the start, I'm on Twitter far too much, frankly, as Hunting English. And you can, via there, you can go onto my website link, which is theconfidentteacher.com. Lots of free resources and hopefully useful articles and blogs on there. And I do host a page on Facebook, which is under my own name, Alex Quigley, with Hunting English, again, kind of linking that up with my work on Twitter. So yeah, I'm on social media a lot. You can likely connect with me very easily on there.
Thank you so much for your time today, Alex.
Thank you, Craig. Thanks for having me.
Next week, join me for episode 32 of the EdTech Chat podcast, when I'm joined by Michael Lubelfeld and Scott McLeod. One of the things I love doing is giving away prizes as a thank you for tuning in, listening, and hopefully subscribing to the EdTech Chat podcast. Last week, I gave away a copy of Thomas Murray's book. To win, you need to complete the form at bit.ly/edtechwin. The winner has already been contacted directly by me, and it is Andrew Bobel. Congratulations, Andrew. This week, I'm giving away a copy of Alex Quigley's book. To win the book, you need to go to bit.ly/edtechwin and complete the simple form. It'll take you less than a minute to do. The link is in the description below. Competition closes on Wednesday the 9th of December, and the winner will be contacted directly by me and announced on next Friday's podcast episode. Good luck. Well, we have two more episodes left in the 2020 series of the EdTech Chat podcast, and I'm thrilled to announce a few changes that are going to come your way when we relaunch again in mid-January 2021. We'll have a new name and a few new workflows to best support you in your listening of this podcast. We'll have more giveaways and even more opportunities for learning. If you enjoyed today's episode, like always, please smash that subscribe button and share it with your colleagues, friends, and families. I really do appreciate your support. Please remember to go back and rate the podcast too. It won't take you long, and it will help us connect to more educators and edtech enthusiasts all over the world. Make sure you go back and share your favorite part of today's episode by tagging me on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, or LinkedIn. And don't hesitate to contact me with any questions that I can answer in an upcoming episode. Remember, you have the chance to win as well. Check out the links in the description for more, and I'll see you again next week.
Thank you for listening to the EdTech Chat Podcast, creating a community for educators to learn, share, and grow. If you like today's episode, please don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss another episode. And be in the drawing to win prizes every week. If you know others that would enjoy the show, please hit that share button and brighten their day. Join us again next week for your weekly EdTech hit with @MrKempNZ. We'll see you again soon.